Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Who's pumped about the Word of the Living God? Man, I'm pumped. I am so pumped about the Word of God. You know, I said last week, as I guess I should try to have a joke, shouldn't I? I'll try this one. This is courtesy of our granddaughter, Aubrey. So I thought this was funny. She has her little bed, her and her mom, and they have their room. And I was doing I don't know if it was a story or telling her something. And I'm sitting on the edge of their bed, maybe a bedtime story where mom was working. I forget how it went. And I'm sitting on her bed, and she said, as I'm telling her this story, and she said, "If you break my bed, it's not my fault." And then I said, "Aubrey, are you trying to say I'm fat?" She said, "No, I'm just saying you're heavy." She's fine. I feel a whole lot better now. So, I'm just heavy. So I thought that was cute. Amen. If you have your outlines, this is called The Great Faith Mistake, Part Number 2. I'll tear that off of there. This is really, really good. I said this last week. I'm going to say it again this week. This message really is a game changer, and we're going to have to marinate in it. And something that I don't often do is all these different scripture verses I have wrote down. A lot of times I don't go to them all, but I'm probably going to try to go to most of these, if not all. And what that means is we probably won't get through this entire thing, but that's okay. This is a game changer, guys. This is a game changer. If you're just trying to take the Bible and apply it without the Holy Spirit, it ain't working. And it won't work, because it's just a form of godliness that denies the power. The Holy Spirit, according to John chapter 16, verse 13, guides us into the truth. He teaches us all things from the Word. We need a personal relationship with God. That's to put it simple. Now, I know people think, honestly, most of us, I don't mean this to be hard. It sounds kind of hard. But a lot of times we're looking for the latest form, the latest Christian fad, the latest thing. What is it? Is it the prayer of Jabez? Whatever it is at the moment. Not that there's not some good things in that. I'm not minimizing that. But there's no substitute for a personal relationship with God. You and I need to learn to draw from God on our... How many of you want answered prayer? Yes, nothing fuels unbelief more than unanswered prayer. And it's never God's fault. Never. It's always something we didn't see or something we didn't hear. Jesus said, let me show it to you. I'm going to take my time. I'm going to show you some of these verses instead of just say them. You need to see them. John 5, 19, and we'll look at John verse 19 and verse 30 of this same chapter. I want you to see this. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself." Stop. Now, if Jesus said that, do you think it applies to you and I? I can do nothing of myself. Was Jesus in relationship with his Father? So just because I have a relationship with God does not mean that I cannot still attempt things of myself, correct? Jesus clarified, he said, "I can't do anything of myself, nothing but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise." He said, "I don't do anything except what I see my Father do." Now question, I ask questions, okay? There's nothing, good questions are good, right? Because they have answers. I said, what do you mean you see? How do you see the Father do these things that you're doing, Jesus? These miracles and all these things you're doing. You know how he saw it? In prayer, in his God-given imagination. He saw himself doing it, and the Father was doing it through him. See, most of us don't, glory to God. Most of us don't do that because we identify with who we are in the flesh instead of who we are in Christ. That's what I said before. People aren't enjoying. The Lord spoke and said, most of my children don't enjoy me. They don't enjoy me. God wants you to enjoy him. Because they're so conscious of where they're not measuring up. How can they see themselves doing the things of God? You're talking about me. I mean, I can see you using someone else. I love what Andrew Womack says. He said, "If you knew me as well as you knew you, you wouldn't have any more confidence in my prayers than you do your own." See, we look at ourselves instead of looking at who we are in Christ. Now look at verse 30 of this same chapter. Look at this, John 5:30. Watch this. "I can of my own self do nothing." He says it again. implying that you can try to do things in your own strength. As I hear, I judge, I discern, and my judgment or discernment is just, it's accurate, it's correct, because I seek not mine own will, boy, we could camp here, but the will of the Father which has sent me. As I hear, I judge. I can't do anything of myself. It's only what I hear and only what I see from God. Now, you know that applies to you and I. And how do you see and hear? Through your times of fellowship with God. Through your times of fellowship with God. Now, we talked about this last week. I want you to see this. I'm going to back up in John 15. I'm going to go to verse 5, and then we're going to shoot for probably verse 7 or 8. But I want to show you something. I saw this. This is so good. John 5. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. I am the vine that supplies the life, you are the branches. He that abides in me, that word abides, we talked about this last week, meno. Everybody say meno. Not minnow, meno. M-E-N-O. It means to reside. It means to dwell. It means to settle. It means to stay put. That's what the Greek word means. So, in other words, he who keeps his faith in me, look at this. And I in him, the same brings forth how much fruit?
Much
fruit. Now, I always thought that fruit in this context was, say, the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians 5, 22 and 23. And certainly that's true also. But I think in context you'll see something here. Look at this. For without me you can do nothing. Just exactly what we read in John 5 that Jesus said. And look at verse 6. If a man abide not in me, he doesn't dwell in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men, not God. How many know there's going to be carnal Christians that make it to heaven? One, we got one hand and one amen. So some of you believe that if you're born again, you're going to heaven. But I'm going to say this to you. We want to make a big difference while we're here. And the way that happens is when we abide in Him. You know, you're not called to just sit here with no purpose. You have purpose. Do you know why you're here right now? You're in Bible college. Our church is a mini Bible college. That's the way all churches should be.
Yes.
We welcome unbelievers to the service, but this is for believers. You know, I don't have time at every message. Well, the New Testament was written in Greek. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew. Sometimes I got to be able to say the Greek word.
Amen.
This is for believers. And if we grow, we're going to change the world out there. Amen. All right. If a man abide not in me, is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, their judgment, and they are burned. Now look at the next verse. This is what I'm after. If you abide in me, we looked at this last week, Jesus speaking, if you keep your faith in me, and my words abide in you. We talked about this, rhema words. Rhema, this word rhema means a revealed word, a now word, a word that God gives you on a daily basis, you could say. Yesterday, I was praying and seeking the Lord, sitting out there, and I just clicked on Facebook on my phone and looked at some of my feet, and a pastor from Tennessee, I'm not kidding, put up a scripture verse out of Psalm 28, verse 7, that I was meditating on probably less than 5 minutes before that. Psalm 28:7. What's the chance of that? What's the chance of that? God's talking. He's talking all the time. It's not a question of whether God's talking. It's a question of whether we're hearing.
Amen.
And see, number one, you got to know that the hearing ear, the seeing eye, the Lord has made them, Proverbs 20, verse 12, and God has given you the ability to hear Him. You start with the Word of God and you stay with the Word of God. And God expands on the Word of God. And it comes to an individual situation, it'll go through the Word of God.
Amen.
All right. Now look, if you abide in me, my words abide in you, then you can ask what you will and it's going to be done for you. You're going to get answered prayers. You know what John 15, 5, without me you can do nothing. You know what the nothing I believe is? You can't get any of your prayers answered without me. You can't. And you know what glorifies the Father? The next verse, here's how the Father's glorified, that you bear much fruit. He's talking about fruit. What is the fruit? Answered prayer fruit. God wants our prayers answered. When I say Father, He says yes. What can I do for you? I'm here. That's what the Father wants. It's called relationship. But it doesn't come unless you get words from the Word. See, notice that it's a twofold condition. You abide in me, you keep your faith in me, and then my words, my individual, revealed, fresh applications of the eternally written Word, fresh revelation from the eternally written Word abides in you. Then you can ask what you will. Why? Because you're seeing what I'm doing. Remember last week we talked about this word ask? It's not just you asking, it's you're so one with Him that He's asking with you. How many know those prayers get answered? All right. I want to differentiate here, and we're going to get in the outline. Last week we talked about the Greek word logos. Logos is the entire embodiment of God's word, right? Jesus is the logos, John 1:1, John 1:14. The entire volume of God's word. But rhema is an individual revelation from the word, right? It's when the word is revealed to your heart, when God speaks that word from the word to your heart. Now, here's the difference. You can have a super nice vehicle. Say it's an all-terrain equipped vehicle. Ram tough. You know, whatever that is. You can have the most awesome vehicle. How many know that's great? It can do everything. You have the vehicle. You own it. You have the title, right? But if you don't have any fuel, as great as that vehicle is, and it's out of fuel, I don't care how ram tough it is. It ain't doing nothing. Everybody got that? That's like logos and rhema. Many of us, we got the word. We've heard many great sermons, but we never let God speak it to us. Are you hearing me? This is why, guys. God's talking. Look at your neighbor and say, God's talking to you. All the time. God's constantly communicating with you. See, and how do you start? You just start. You start right where you're at. You have a time. I'm going to get into unplug time. Why it's important to have a time where you unplug from the noise of this fallen world. If you never unplug from the noise of this fallen world, it's going to be very difficult for you to hear. Now, God's still trying to talk. God loves you, guys. It has nothing to do with God's love for you. You know why God corrects you and I? Because He loves us.
Yes, He does.
Every son gets chastened by the Word of God. Now look at this. All right, let's go. All right, let's go. Here we go. New and review is the first thing in your outline. Right place, wrong time, without abiding in Him. Jesus said in this John 15 context, we looked at it last week in verse 3, you're clean through the word, the logos that I have spoken unto you. You are clean. That's your position. Everybody say position. My position in Christ. But without a rhema word of God, I can have a right word, but not be in the right place. Amen? You can have the word, but you're not following His lead. As many as, look at this. We got to go there. Romans 8. Look at Romans 8, 14. Look at this. Romans 8, 14. This is so good. Watch this. 8, 14. That's good though too. Romans chapter 8, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Weos for sons, mature sons, as many as are led. It's because they're sons of God. Okay? So if you're a son of God, you can be led. Look at the next verse. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. The Amplified says the slavish spirit of bondage. What is this talking about? You have not received an old covenant legalistic mentality that promotes fear if you don't measure up. You haven't received that spirit again to fear. You know the language of this earth is fear. The Lord was speaking to me this morning and showing me most of my children never step out because they live in fear. Fear is the language of this fallen world. You know how many fears attack me and you? Man, it's constant. Every little pain. Oh, my word. That's epidermal leg syndrome. What is that? I don't know, but somebody will come up with it. I'm serious. Why can't, what, the phone rings late at night. Oh my word, what could it be? How about, man, what good news? Couldn't wait until the morning. This must really be good news. Because we're so conditioned by fear because that's the system we live in. And you know, the Bible says God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and of a sound mind. But you got to read that in context in 2 Timothy 1:7. You back up one verse, he says, stir up the gift that's in you. Stir that gift up, that charisma, that gift, that baptism in the Holy Ghost, and it will empower you when fear comes to overcome it.
That's right. Amen.
Fear is the language of this fallen system. Now watch this. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of sonship, adoption, whereby in our heart we cry, Daddy God, Abba Father. Now look at this next verse. His spirit bears witness with our spirit, the spirit himself, I don't like itself, it's himself, New King James, beareth witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Now watch this. Where does the Holy Spirit bear witness with? My brain or my spirit? My spirit, okay. How do I even get on that frequency? You get into the Word of God. You get into the Word of God. You start seeing who you are as a born-again child of God in the Spirit. And then His Spirit will bear witness with your spirit. The Holy Spirit only guides you into truth, and His Word is truth. If there's no truth in you, He has nothing to guide you into or from. This is why the Word of God is so important. If it's not in your heart, He has nothing to... So many people... I cannot even tell you that probably the number of people that have come to me and they got a word from God with no word from the Word. I got a word from God. Really? Where's that at in the Word? Well, it ain't in there. Well, what validates it? It ain't in there. I don't know. But I got a word. It ain't from God. You know how much deception is going on in the world right now? You know how much deception, let me rephrase that. You know how much deception is going on in the body of Christ right now? I just did a post yesterday. Awesome post. It's an arrogant thing. God gave it to me, brag on Him. I'm just saying what you're thinking. All right, I'm kidding. But it was about this, I called it, is the world getting better? You know, there's people teaching. Listen to this, guys. There's people teaching that our world is getting better. And we're already in the new heavens and the new earth, and that the judgment came in 70 AD when the Romans leveled Jerusalem, and that was Jesus' return in judgment, and now we're in a new heavens and a new earth. We're in the new kingdom. Pure garbage. But let me tell you something that has some truth in it. See, they'll say stuff like, well, you know, we're more advanced now. Technology, we can do more advanced surgeries. The world's getting better. No, it's not. Here's the problem with the world, man's heart. The corruption is in the world because of man's lust. But I went on and said, I said, here's what people don't get. They don't understand spirit, soul, and body. Jesus is present with me in my born-again spirit, in the person of the Holy Ghost, Christ in me, the hope of glory. But this isn't my glorified body, and Jesus is still going to physically return. See these people. All right. You know what this is? It's the same demon that moves through liberal politics. Because here's what it says. Mankind's basically good. And we can negotiate with terrorists because we're all God's children. No, we're not. We're not all good. And we can't all sit around and determine right and wrong. That goes right back to the garden. You'll be as gods, knowing good and evil. It may be wrong for you to commit murder, but it's okay for me. No, it's wrong for everyone. It may be wrong for you to kill an unborn baby, but it's okay for me. It's wrong. It's murder. There are some absolutes. But see, Satan's goal is to get us to throw out all absolutes, and once we throw out all absolutes, we become our own God, determining what's right and wrong. Can anybody see it? Amen. Moving right along. John 15:3, we talked about that. John 15:7, I talked about that. The now word, the rhema word in your outline, is necessary to be in the right place to receive answers. To be in the right place to receive answers. Result of answered prayers, you glorify the Father. And the rhema word of God flows from the Logos. Now here's where we're going to take our time. Number two, how important is it to receive now words, revealed words? How important is it? Here's what I call the how-to when it comes to responding in situations. Acts chapter 16. You guys ever heard them Bible tapes? I find my, does anybody ever do anything weird? This is one of the weird things I do. I'll walk around, I'll be by myself, and then Bible tapes, you know, Acts chapter 16. I just like to sound like that guy. Acts. I can do it with Acts. I can't do it with the other books. Acts chapter 16. Look at verse 16. Watch this. A lot to be said here. We're going to cover these verses. Before I say this, I want to say one other thing. This is why people blame God. You know, it's easy to blame God. It's easy to say, well, God killed this person because they need another flower in heaven. You know, that's the easiest thing. I told you the story about, it was Keith Moore shared when he's a pilot and he was flying his jet or a jet, and he was learning how to fly, and he was, you know, getting to the place. I think that's where he was at in his flight understanding. And he said they got in the plane, they were getting ready to go, and all of a sudden there's this pin that has to do with the steering on the wheels, and it has to be, if it's not in, there's no steering. And he said, or if it's not turned one way or however it is. And he said, when they got in, he asked the superior pilot or the more seasoned pilot, he said, did you check that pin in the steering thing? He goes, oh yeah. He goes, it kind of came to him. So, and they're just getting ready, doing their pre-flight check. and they're doing all this stuff, and he says, and all of a sudden it came to him again. I said, did you check that pin to make sure it was turned the right way? It had to be turned up or down or sideways. Did you check it? He goes, I told you, I checked it. It's okay. So they continue doing their thing, and now they've got the motors fired up, so they're burning fuel, and jet fuel's not cheap. Okay? So the motors are fired up, and all of a sudden it came to him again, and Keith said, he goes, shut her down. We need to check this. And so they went out and checked it, and wouldn't you know it, it was in the wrong position. And had they taken off in that position? See, was God trying to get it through to them?
Yes.
You know, when people go home early, somebody's not hearing God. It's not a condemning thing. If you're born again, you go to heaven. But God wants to protect us. Amen? And when you know it wasn't turned, you know, what would happen if they would have took off and all of a sudden they would have no steering and they would have went out of control and, you know, they'd have, God took our pastor because God needed another lily in heaven. How many know that's not God? But see, people say that all the time. I realized this past week. I said, you know, it is easy. It is easy to proclaim a gospel. You can be a popular Christian in the world if you just say, well, God does it. You never know what God's going to do. That kind of gospel, which it doesn't even cause you to be persecuted. But when you say stuff like God's good, it's not God's will for you to be sick, God wants you well, God wants you, oh, then you get persecuted. You preach the other kind, you don't even get persecution. My Bible tells me that all who will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. If no one's coming against you, you're not living godly. Whew. Somebody help me. If no one's coming, that's 2 Timothy 3:12. If no one's persecuting you for your stand of faith, you are not living godly. I didn't say you weren't a Christian, but godliness will cause you to be persecuted. And most of the persecution comes from religion. One of my buddies, Christian man, I let him borrow Andrew's God Wants You Well CDs. And he came back and said, no, I'm not. I can't handle that guy. He said, if you sin, he said, sickness is because you sinned. I go, he did not. I go, here's what he said. He said, sickness is in the world because of sin. Started with Adam. That's why it's here. That's the truth. These people that say this stuff, listen, the Bible says we're to pray his kingdom come, his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. If sickness is his will, that means there must be sickness in heaven. Wrong. That's wrong. That's incorrect. But if you don't stand up for these things, you won't be persecuted. In fact, you can be elected to office.
Amen.
Seriously. When you say, then why do you struggle with sin? Listen, I'm struggling with, I don't do everything. Sometimes I miss the mark. The Bible says that which is not faith is sin. I don't hit everything right, but I'm not the standard. God's word is. And I'm going to proclaim it because it's the truth. But see, that's when you get persecuted. You know, you're not a cult until you start saying God wants you well. I love Pastor Dwayne Sheriff because you ain't done squat for God unless you've been called a cult. Who cares? All right. Acts 16:16. And it came to pass as we went to prayer. Isn't that interesting? The enemy does not want you to pray. Well, we're supposed to pray without ceasing. Yes, we are. But you know, there's a time. Let me put it to you this way. How many know I'm married? Nobody? Okay, I am. All right. How many know that we're in constant communion? How many know that there's times we lock the bedroom door? Do I need to go further? Okay. Judy liked that. I seen her over there. You know, that's a sign of a healthy marriage. You know, God created sex. You know that? It's a wonderful thing. It's amazingly awesome. It's glorious. It's worship. I heard Joseph Prince say that. You're worshiping God. Honey, let's go worship. Very spiritual man. And it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. Okay? Demonic activity. Agreed? Next verse. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation." Now stop. The Greek does not say the way. There's no definite article in the Greek. It would be better translated, "They show unto us a way." Hear how close that is? Oh, that just, you know, it's just, what do they call that? Play on words. What's that? Semantics. That's what I'm looking for. It's just, you know, but no, this something. Now, keep reading. We'll just keep going. They followed Paul and us, and they cried. She cried, saying, "These men are men of the." That's true. They show unto us way of salvation. Oh, maybe she just forgot the word. Next verse. And this she did for many days. Watch this. And Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come out of her." And he came out. And he came out of her the same hour. There's so much to be said here. But you know, first of all, she did this for many days. And something just wasn't right. You know what that tells me? Sometimes we make knee-jerk reaction, we make quick decisions, and we don't marinate. And that's... I'm going to say this. This will help you. I see this a lot in relationships. You know, people... I tell people all the time, I cannot tell you the people I've told, listen, if you get close to somebody prematurely, no good. Oh, I'm in control. You're lying to yourself. Amen. Ain't nobody in control. Amen. Amen? And this is what happens. We don't pull back and we don't discern. And I'm telling you, it's so imperative that we don't override God's way. Most of the trouble in our lives is because we did it our way. Seriously. It's not, if God was leading us the whole time. And in this situation, she did this for many days. Paul turned and he spoke to the Spirit so many times behind situations. The Bible says in Ephesians 6, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we do against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. Many times there's demonic opposition operating behind people. Not all the time, but a lot of times. That's another big teaching. I can tell you there's so many goofball teachings. Well, there's no devil. There's no demonic realm. It's just all in your heart. There's one teaching that goes so far as to saying that the devil is basically just your carnal mind. Isn't that amazing? How do you cast the carnal mind into pigs? Show me how that works, because I wouldn't mind doing it. Go! I'm good now. I only think good. Amen. Next verse. Notice, and the Spirit came out the same hour. Keep going. Next verse 20. I'm sorry. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains, when you touch the pocketbook, was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace under the rulers, next verse, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men being Jews do exceedingly trouble our city. Next verse. And teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. Next verse. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates ripped off their clothes and rent or tore their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into the prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Keep going. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. Now, I've heard that the prison they were in, when they were chained against the wall next to Uga and Olga, I can't prove that, but that there was a grate and that human feces would come down on them in the inner stocks. That's how bad it was. These guys weren't lifting weights. They weren't watching TV. They weren't throwing horseshoes. It was not a good place. Amen? Now, all they were doing was the work of the Lord, right? They were simply, they cast a demon out of a girl. Where's the joy and the peace? Man, we're just doing your will. I used to have a mindset that, man, if I'm in God's will, things ought to just go easy. You know, the opposite is true. If you don't run into the devil, it's because you're flowing with him. We have this mindset. It's an American mindset. It's a Western society mindset. That's what I said. If you don't stand up for truth and the full gospel in this country, at least right now, you won't even be persecuted. You'll actually be accepted. He's a good man. She's a good woman. They got Christian faith. Keep going. They threw him fast in the stocks. Next verse. And at midnight, Paul and Silas whined and complained and said, God, why did you do this to us? No. At midnight, they prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. You know, if we would just take this example, you'll see the results here in a minute. They prayed, the prisoners heard them. I told my wife the other day, we were standing there, and I'm thinking, why don't we have praise music going on in this house? She said, you're right, let's put it on. So I clicked on the YouTube on the TV and just type in worship, let her play. It's awesome. It's awesome. We need to be praisers. See, we're postponing our joy because we're waiting on life to be fair. We're waiting on things to work out and not to have any more problems. That doesn't happen in this world. And in fact, the more you go into God's plan for your life, you're going to get some opposition. Not everybody's going to agree with you. Just tone it down a little bit. Just calm down. You can be a Christian, but just be a Christian like all the other ones are, and just be more concerned about your creature comforts than you are the kingdom of God. The Bible talks about people who would be lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. It didn't say they wouldn't love God. It said they would love pleasure for more. And then it said, stay away from them.
That's true. Amen.
Listen, God gives us richly all things to enjoy. I'm not against that. But where is my heart? Where is my heart? Where is my heart? You know how short a time we got on this planet? God wants to use you and I to make an eternal difference. He's graced us to do that. Glory to God. You're not here just to exist and live and work and eat and then retire and have enough money to sit on the can. You're here to make a difference. You're here to make an eternal difference.
Amen.
I'm jumping ahead of myself, but I'll do it anyhow. In this outline, I want to get to where, how many have heard, preach the word, and if necessary, use words. Who's heard that? Augustine quote. I think it's Augustine. You all heard that? There's only one thing wrong with it. It's not biblical. Oh my word. I didn't know it would be that rejected. Persecution. I'm kidding. No. I know what the point. We need to let our lifestyle reflect what we say we believe. I got that. That's great. But scripturally, you need to open your mouth. Come on. This is the kingdom of God, Paul. And listen, we need prayer. Thank you. We need prayer that we would speak the word boldly. Look what Paul said in Ephesians 6:19-20. This is the Apostle Paul. Watch this. And we'll come back here and we'll finish. And for me, Paul's saying, for me, pray for me that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my light, my mouth, boldly, to make known the mystery of the gospel. Next word, verse. For which I am an ambassador in bonds, in chains, that there and I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Speak. He said, pray for me. Most Christians don't even think like that. Who wants to be on God's frequency? You know what's easier? You know an easy message? You know God loves you unconditionally. That's awesome and great. But God's unconditional love, He wants to flow through you to give that unconditional love out there to people who need it.
Amen.
Come on. Come on. We can go back to Acts 16:25. But I want to say this. And listen, I don't hit it every time, and I'm not condemned. I told my wife the other day, we was witnessing to a guy, said, and we were walking out, and we think, well, we probably should have did this and that. And we just both said, we're not condemning ourselves. We just open our mouth. It's the Holy Spirit's job to use the words. We were in Kroger the other week, and we would come down the aisle, and I looked down there, two Mormon missionaries, and there I go. My wife knows, that's my department. That's my department. And if some have compassion, making a difference, and others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. The Lord told me very simply, when dealing with Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses or whatever, give them Jesus.
Yes.
Most cases, I know more about their doctrine than they do. And seriously, I don't mean that arrogantly. I've studied it. And you don't have to be an extra, but I just keep telling them the Jesus of the LDS Church, the Latter-day Saints, the Mormons, is a different Jesus in the Bible. And if you're on the, and if you believe wrong, you're headed wrong.
Amen.
And I ask him, have you ever heard 2 Corinthians 11:4? Most of them haven't. But yet they claim to believe the King James Bible insofar as it's translated correctly, which means if it agrees with LDS teaching. That's what that means. But I have to do this. And I said, I'm not condescending to you guys. I love you guys. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing. I said, it would be so much easier for me to just walk past and not even talk about this. That would be what I'd like to do. You think I want to stand in a grocery store and get in a big doctrinal dissertation? Oh, it was good. It was good, but I said, listen, I just kept giving them Jesus. I go, the Jesus of the LDS Church is not the Jesus of the Bible. You need to check it out. You don't have to be an expert. Just tell them about Jesus, the Jesus of the Bible. Just tell them about we believe in Jesus. Yes, but the Bible warns of another Jesus. And if you turn the road sign and you think you're on the road to get to my house, it does not matter how sincere you are, somebody's turned the road sign. But here's my point. Lord, I pray, help me to speak the word boldly as I ought.
Amen.
See, if I don't ever get persecuted, that means I'm not living godly. If no one ever comes against me or says this or says all those things, you know, one thing we are not redeemed from is persecution. Did you know that? 2 Timothy 3:12, all, somebody say all, who will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. You know, the gospel of grace will cause you to be persecuted. You know how many times, oh, you're just saying it don't matter how you live. I'm not saying it don't matter how I live. I'm saying what Paul said. Should we sin that grace may abound? God forbid. That's what I'm saying. Amen. Praise God. I didn't mean to get off on that. Back to Acts 16. We will finish that. Acts chapter 16. Boy, there's some really good ones. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. At midnight, the darkest hour. What do you and I do in our darkest hour? I like to complain sometimes. Am I the only honest one here? Thank you. But they sang praises unto God. Now watch this. And the prisoners heard them. The others that were in bondage heard them. Next verse. And suddenly, you know, that's how your deliverance comes.
Yeah.
Suddenly. 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 And suddenly there was a great earthquake. Not an earthquake, a great one. Earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loose. You know, when you sing praises, God gets to tapping his foot and it causes... No, I don't know if that's... But you know, it can cause an earthquake and cause your situation to turn around.
Amen.
Isn't that powerful? He inhabits those praises. Most of us, hear me, most of us identify with circumstances more than we identify with Christ. That's why we're waiting. I did this post. We're waiting on the world to be fair, and then we'll be full of joy. I got news for you. This fallen world will never be fair. It's not fair that you and I were born in America when other people were born in countries where they don't have anything. That's not fair to them. See, it's all in perspective. Somebody say, I don't have anything to praise God about. Are you born again? Are you born again? You're going to heaven.
Hallelujah.
Amen. You know how many of you get up in the morning and say, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Jesus said in John 14, I believe it's 28, he said, I'm going to the Father. If you love me, you would rejoice. Oh, glory. We're passing through. Amen. Oh, glory to God. I'm getting excited. Suddenly there was an earthquake, a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison were shaken. Immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loosed. Next verse. And the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. Next verse. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we're all here. Next verse. Then he called for a light and sprang and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. Next verse. And brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Next verse. He says, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice he didn't say, repent, do all these things. He said, just believe on Jesus. Put your faith in him and what he's done. And you shall be saved and thy house. Now let me say one more verse. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. How many of you know that from the very beginning, Paul had a word from the Lord that caused them to be thrown in prison? How many of you know that there was a time when it maybe didn't look like a word from the Lord? Because they were thrown in prison, right? But how many of you know it turned out for the glory of God? This guy in his house would have not been saved had they not followed the word of the Lord. But let me say this to you too. Sometimes when you get a word from God, it seems like all H-E double hockey sticks breaks loose. If it's a true word from God. But this is why, I'm going to say this and then I'm going to wrap up. This is why you need the ministry of the Holy Ghost. This is why it's important to be built up. This is why the baptism in the Holy Spirit is so important. You cannot function with just your own human strength. You can't. You can't. The world's too overwhelming. Has anybody else ever struggled with like being down or being depressed? Anybody else? Yeah, we all have. Now let go. I want you to go to 2 Timothy chapter 1. We're wrapping. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7. Very familiar verse. Amplified. Please. Watch this. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, of cowardness, of craven and cringing and fawning fear. But he has given us the spirit of power and of love and of calm and a well-balanced mind. Don't you love that? A calm and a well-balanced mind. How many know that? But how many, watch this, let me finish. And discipline and self-control. This is what God gave us. So fear is not of God, right? But what is the verse before that? Watch this. How many know this doesn't automatically manifest in your life without your consent and cooperation? Does it? Look at the verse before that. This is why I would remind you. I would remind you, watch this, to stir up, rekindle the embers of, fan the flame, and keep burning the gracious gift, the charisma of God, the inner fire that is in you by the means of the laying on of my hands with those of the elders at your ordination. Paul's telling Timothy, I want to remind you that you fan the flame of this fire that you received through the laying on of hands. What do you receive through the laying on of hands? It was the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And he said, you stir this up, you fan it into flame, and guess what happens? Fear cannot stand against that flame. The Lord was showing me this morning, listen, you know why the Bible says pray without ceasing? Anybody know? 1 Thessalonians 5:17. You know why it says that? Because 1 John 5:19 says the whole world lies in wickedness. The whole world lies in wickedness. He said, you need to build yourself up much more than you do, not to earn anything from God. God loves me if I never pray, if I never read my Bible. God's love for me is based on the fact that He's love. But if I don't stir up the gift that's in me, the baptism in the Holy Ghost, then when fear comes, it will overpower me. When anxiety and all these things that come at every one of us, this is why people go down, because they're not stirred up. If you don't stay stirred up, you will settle to the bottom. I love the way one man of God says, he says, you're dealing with this, you're dealing with this. You walk the floor, you're praying in the Holy Ghost. That's praying in other tongues, by the way. You're praying in the Spirit, you're building yourself up, you're fanning the flame. Fear's coming at you. These thoughts are coming at you. What's going to happen here? What's going to happen there? You keep fanning the flame, you keep fanning the flame. And all of a sudden, whoo, the inner fire burns on the inside of you. And all of a sudden, that fear can't stand. That fear can't stand. You ever seen a fire? You have a campfire or a fireplace or whatever? You see that thing? When you fan it, they call it a billows. We call it a bee smoker. Whatever works, right? And you fan that thing and all of a sudden, whoom. How do you fan the flame? You pray in the Spirit. You build yourself up on your most holy faith. Keep yourself in the love of God. You fan the flame. Fear's attacking. Fear's attacking. Fan the flame. Sometimes you may go for a long time, but guess what? Sooner or later, whoom, you fan the flame. Amen. And this will help you get a rhema word from the Lord. We got a lot more. We got down to number 2, Acts 16, but I want to get into all these other scriptures. I want to show you how powerful it is to get a word from God. When God gives you a word and it's a true word from God, let me tell you something, nothing can take it from you. And I can guarantee you this, it will come to pass. It will come to pass. Amen? Amen? See, this is where the enemy, that's why the enemy attacks your hope. Hold on, Christian, I'm just about done. I just want to say this. A lot of times the fears that are coming against us, I'll use myself as an example. Are you ready? Can you all relate? I've laid my whole life down for this. I have no plan B. How many of you know I'm a few years over 32 now? Okay? Fear tries to get on me. What are you going to do? What about this? What about a retirement? What about this? What all these things? How you got this set up? You know, Social Security might not even be here. All these different things they say. All these fears try to get on me. The Lord said, I'm your source. You look to me. I think, Lord, have I really done what you've told me to do? Or is this my own thing? You know what when I ask God for, Lord, is there anything else? You know what I get? Deafening silence. Nothing. You're doing what I've called you to do. Now just keep doing it. One of the hardest things to do, hear me, the easiest to preach, hardest to do, is to remain faithful. Oh, it preaches good. Just be faithful, brother. Until you're in the middle of it. It takes the grace of God. Now the God of hope, John 15:13, God of hope, confident, joyful, expectation of good, fill you with all joy and peace in believing. You abound in hope, but it's through the power of the Holy Ghost, not your own human effort. You need the Holy Ghost. If you got a promise from God and you know it's from God, you got to be honest with yourself. That's a hard thing for us. But when I know it's from God, I just keep going. Lord said, just stay put. You just keep going. You keep your eyes on me. You keep doing what I've told you to do. And you don't look to the right or to the left. You ponder the path of your feet. You just keep going in the kingdom of God. Those promises will come to pass. Amen. I know, Christian, you've tried to stop me a couple hours ago, but amen. God wants your prayers answered. The manifestation may not always be when you think it should be, but if you'll stay put with a word from God, with rhemas from God, God will give them to you on a daily basis. Because you need to know how to stand every day. Not just, well, I know how to stand yesterday. That's good. That's living on yesterday's manna. Amen? God wants you to live on today's manna. Are you blessed? Yes. Amen. Praise God. Give the Lord a hand. Right now, if there's anybody here that doesn't know Jesus, you've never been born again. It's very important that you're born again, that you receive Jesus. I'm going to say a prayer. You can say the prayer, and it won't profit you unless you mix it with faith. Amen? So say, Jesus, I receive you as my Lord and Savior this day. I believe you died for my sins, and that on the third day, God raised you from the dead. I accept you as my Lord, and I believe you're my Savior in Jesus' name. Number two, the baptism in the Holy Ghost. You cannot underestimate how powerful it is. You can't. And it comes with the language. You know, I have noticed over the years, 33 plus years as an intense Christian, I have noticed that the people that stay on fire many times have received the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And the ones that don't, they just either reject it or they don't think it's that important. It's important. Paul said, I thank my God, I speak in tongues more than you all. Yet in the church, I'd rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. Also, which means that's how God was teaching Paul, through that prayer language in his private prayer time. I'm telling you, you need it. You need it. We have a book for you, and if you're interested in it, we've got people around here that will pray with you, and also physical healing. Right now, I speak healing to those that are in need of healing in Jesus' mighty name. And if there's people around here that will pray with you, we want to believe God for healings in any area of your life. Listen, we all get attacked with things. You know that. I'll use me again. Okay, I haven't ran for 10 days. Have you noticed? You know why? Because I've been getting this pain right here. Well, tomorrow I'm going to start again. It's feeling pretty good. But you know, there's a time, you know, the H word. That stands for hernia, in case you're wondering. All these things try to get on you. I say, no, in the name of Jesus, by his stripes I'm healed. I'm fighting it. Now, if you have to get medical help, that's awesome. I mean, God, we just believe. It's more awesome if you don't need that. But there's no Listen, doctors and Christians that believe in healing are on the same team. The same team. We're the same goal. Thank God for good doctors. But I don't want to go to one. I want this thing to take care of itself, and I want to start running again. Amen? So I'm just believing it's a pulled muscle. I'm going to try to run tomorrow. So if you hear of a world record, you know. Amen. But we need to pray for our country. Amen? We need to pray for our country. Pray for our president, our vice president, their families. Father God, the House and Senate and all the leaders in the United States, every governor, mayor of a town, Father God, in Jesus' name, township trustee, county commissioners, that they would live quiet and peaceable lives, that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ would spread throughout this nation and around the world. Father, I'm decreeing supernatural Holy Ghost revival of the magnitude that we have never, ever seen before in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Praise the Lord. You are blessed. Guys, I have to tell you this before I let you go. I'm just pumped. There's so much more in here that I want to get to. God wants to teach us all so much. And God, listen, when you leave this place, the Lord is with you. He never leaves you nor forsakes you. And he wants, even as you go home, you know, begin to ask the Lord, speak to me, Lord. Show me stuff from your word. God will speak to you. Isn't that exciting? You'll get impressions in your heart and you'll think, is that you, Lord? Well, you have to ask yourself, am I that smart? Moving right along. Give someone a hug. You're blessed.